Friends, we want to welcome you to worship here at the Dorset Church. The peace and love of the Lord be with you. I wanted to start our service this day with a story that was shared with me a while ago. And the story takes place back in the years long before laptops were in everybody's possession, and when our desktop computers still looked like small television sets. And there was a young couple who lived on the East Coast who just had a newborn baby. And one set of grandparents lived on the West Coast. And they had a difficult time ever trying to make it to the East Coast. So for a number of years, this infant grew to be a three-year-old toddler, and the only exposure, the only relationship that this little girl had with her West Coast grandparents was through Skype. So one day, this precocious little toddler says, "Daddy, I'd like us to visit the grandmother who lives in the box." I think in lots of ways we all feel like we live in the box right now. We all feel boxed in, some of us more so than others. And I know that here at Dorset Church we are doing our utmost to think outside the box. And so, in an attempt for us to spiritually transcend the containment in which we live, I call us to worship with the words of Isaiah, who said, "They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint." Shall we join our hearts and our minds and our souls as we worship God this day? Shall we call each other to worship our God? Sometimes we feel like people of dry bones, hopeless and helpless.
God says, "We shall be raised up from our living graves and be filled with the Holy Spirit."
These challenging times have made us cut off from one another and our normal routines.
God says, "We shall be home wherever and however we live, if we live in God."
And so as we worship this day, let us accept the holiest of welcomes and learn to dwell with God. Amen.
Let us share our prayer of confession. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the source of pure love, you call us to be children of one human family. Yet, we confess that we often turn away from others to seek our own benefit. We take what we don't need because we can. We don't want to be told what to do, and so we put others in danger. Forgive us, Lord, and help us to live in harmony as we mindfully come together as one in spirit and in love. Let us take a moment for our own silent confession. And now, let us share the assurance of our forgiveness. The truth exposes each of us. Truth can humble all of us. Truth can hurt. And truth can heal. Let us follow in the way of truth, which leads to your love. Amen. And now is a time for us to come together in our pastoral prayer. Let us pray. O Lord, during this Lenten journey, we come to you as people filled with fear and anxiety. We know that you walked a road of sacrifice, and most often you walked alone. And now, dear Lord of all, we walk with you. As we journey ahead, help us to remember those that have high risk factors for catching the virus, those who sit alone, lonely and frightened, those who live paycheck to paycheck and now have no income, and those who think this time of inconvenience is only for them. Oh God, we ask that you release us from this fear and stress so that we may become the ones who take a risk and shop for our neighbors, that we take on the responsibility of calling the lonely and frightened, and that we help to provide the means to feed our hungry community members. Lord, we ask for your healing embrace that will comfort those, especially those on our prayer list. We pray for baby James and Jane and Chet Evans, for Helene Giotti and Andrew Leeds, for Annie Downey and Doris Ibbotson, for Mary Abbott Ludke. We keep in our prayers Terry Archard and Bonnie Franklin, Jameson Gray Pelton and Betsy LaVecchia. We hope for healing for Vern James and Arthur Jones and Audrey Brass, and for Roger Leeds, Cheryl Gasparetti, Warren Johnson, and Carl Hedman. In our own church community, we give thanks and pray for our cleaning staff, Lynn and Pete Jennings. In the Vermont Conference, we pray for our friends at the First Congregational Church of Fairhaven. And in the UCC, our denomination, we pray for St. Paul's in St. Mary's, Ohio, with their effort to feed the homeless during this pandemic. Oh God, help us to feel the Holy Spirit of love that travels throughout the land. Let us open our hearts and give thanks, for we are people that have homes to be quarantined in. We have a community that takes responsibilities seriously. And Lord, we know that until we can physically wrap our arms around our friends and loved ones, we know you are with us. Help us to embrace each other with prayers of healing and with loyalty. As we walk this journey with you, O Lord, we pray. In the name of Jesus, our brother and our Lord, amen.
Friends, the sermon this morning is entitled Addition by Subtraction. And the scripture stories are included in the main body of the sermon. I'll be reading them as a part of it. So I invite us to begin in the spirit and word of prayer. Let us pray. O God of love, O God of truth, let us say strong things gently and gentle things strongly. Let us speak the truth in love to all and love the truth that lives in each. Let us hear the truth as we each need it and live that truth. O God, we heed it through Jesus, your word and our Lord. Amen. So during this pandemic, the school buildings are all closed, but education is still going on. And many, many of our friends are doing their best to homeschool their kids. They love them dearly, but this new layer of responsibility is really testing that love. Like the post that we received the other day from a newly homeschooling mom. It said, it's been a rough day. Two students suspended for fighting and teacher fired for drinking on the job. Homeschooling arithmetic would scare me the most. I still get nightmares from my high school algebra class. But that was when math was taught the old-fashioned way. Now, modern math is an entirely different enterprise. I remember years ago trying to help my three sons with their high school math, and it was like learning a foreign language. Luckily, they have their mother's mathematical mind, and so they ended up teaching me instead of me teaching them. And speaking of Esther, she has some helpful homeschooling math tips for third graders. Number one, have fun cooking with your children and use the recipes for teaching fractions. Number two, practice estimating. Estimating is a key math skill. So, for example, have your kids estimate how many pairs of shoes your entire family owns, and then go verify. Number three, play card games with your kids. Start simple. Start with, say, a simple game of war. Then graduate by adding up two, three, as many cards as possible. Then, if you're really bold, ramp up to multiplication. And Esther says, most of all, create a routine and stick to it. And let's be sure that a part of that routine should include recess. Now, I may have very little to offer about homeschooling math, but there is a great deal of spiritual arithmetic that we need to learn as a part of our faith. And one key formula is this: faithful addition comes from faithful subtraction. Throughout the scriptures, there is a thread to follow of addition by subtraction. And this morning, I want to share three different stories about it. The first story is this, from the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 16, beginning at verse 16. Moses said, "This is what the Lord commands. Gather as much as you and your household need, one omer apiece." So some gathered more and some gathered less. But when all was gathered, there was nothing left over. But some did not listen and gathered more than their share. And in the morning, the leftovers went foul and became full of worms. My Lord, could there be a more pertinent example for these coronavirus days, the addition to the common good by the subtraction of selfish greed. On TV, we've seen the stockpiling going on by healthy private citizens, why vulnerable Americans who should not go shopping go without some of the basics. And then there's the lack of stockpiling of necessary masks and respirators and gowns and testing kits, etc. We have lost all sense of what is necessary and confused it with what's luxury. This Exodus story highlights a godly truth. God's law dictates the good of the whole should always trump the desires of the few. And this story tries to teach the people of God to know when they have had enough. I find it sadly ironic that the greatest imbalance of wealth on this planet occurs in the country with the deepest roots in democracy. The word democracy comes from two Greek words, demos, meaning people, and kratos, meaning rule. Democracies exist to rule for and by the people. Meanwhile, there's another word also composed of two Greek words. That word is pandemic. Pan meaning all, demos meaning people. Two very similar sounding words, two drastically different meaning words. And the powers that be have had difficulty separating the two. Yes, my dear friends, the spiritual arithmetic of Exodus is truly an addition by subtraction story. The God of the Israelites commanded the subtraction of personal greed for the addition of social need, so that millions around our world won't have a fouled life and feel like leftovers. But you know, during this coronavirus scare, parts of the society have seemed soft-hearted. They have intuitively done the math. Some social media have seen profiteering be obscene. Some U.S. mortgage lenders are granting forbearances. Some landlords are offering rent moratoriums. And amazingly, capitalism and socialism have become kissing cousins. So now I move to the second biblical story of addition by subtraction. This comes from the Gospel according to Luke and the wonderful story of Martha and Mary from chapter 10, beginning at verse 38. A woman named Martha welcomed Jesus into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at Jesus' feet, listening to his teaching. But Martha interrupted and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work? Tell her to help me." But Jesus responded, "Martha, Martha, you are distracted by so many things. But Mary, Mary has chosen the good portion, which shall never be taken away from her." Whereas the Exodus story is about social arithmetic, this one is about personal math. The subtraction of distraction for the addition of deepening relationships of love. We live in a world of multitasking and workaholism. We are like those entertainers juggling dishes, first two, then three, then four, then five, until the audience is wowed. I have seen some of those performances. Some of them have ended in broken dishes. But the coronavirus thrusts us into a whole new reality. Shelter in place has forced us to focus on home life. All day long, as I look out my window, I have seen couples walking arm in arm, busily chatting, smiling, hugging each other in the chilly weather. I've heard that stores are completely sold out of board games, and you can't find a jigsaw puzzle to save your life. Trying new recipes, baking, soup making, has turned kitchens into small factories, and spring cleaning is at full tilt. It's as if we have all been caught in a Martha moment, and Jesus is saying to each of us, you've been distracted by too many things that you've lost sight of what the good proportionality is that breeds a soulful life. In Martha's case, too much work has created a rift between she and her sister and she and her Lord. And Jesus suggests that our soulful priorities should be our relationships of love, and especially how we love our Lord. The third and final lesson of addition by subtraction is found in this short Bible story from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verse 35. In the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place to be alone and to pray. Meanwhile, his friends were hunting for him, saying, "Everyone wants you." I believe this coronavirus will test our limitations of love, if it hasn't already. And many, many might feel guilty that they're not having warm, fuzzy feelings 100% of the time, especially toward their spouses, their children, friends and family, most of all toward ourselves. But we're not the Messiah. We are only human. And even Jesus needed some alone time. He needed to subtract himself from everyone to be alone with himself and with his God. In a rather edgy book entitled The Fall of Public Man, Richard Sennett warns that there is a major confusion going on in society between our public and private lives. In that confusion, we have lost our sense of self. We try to give equal love to everyone, both public and private. But Sennett says it can't be done. We have expected too much perfection of our love, and as a consequence, we have watered it down to superficiality. Take those spring breakers we saw on TV in Florida. At first, I was so angry at them when I heard one say, "Coronavirus be damned, nothing is going to keep me from my fun." Governor Newsom of California called them selfish. And in one way, he was right. But underneath their selfishness, I believe there was a lost selfhood. They don't know who they are alone by themselves. They don't know their value apart from the crowd. They have been so well taught to perform for the public, to be evaluated by an audience, to live life according to public opinion, so much so that they have lost that selfhood that only comes from aloneness. "Everyone wants you," the disciples complained to Jesus. He knew that. But he also knew the only way he could fully be there for them, for the world, was to renew himself with God. Jesus was like that parent taking an airplane flight with a child. During the pre-flight safety lessons, the flight attendant coaches the parents, "Put the oxygen mask on yourself first before you help your child." Jesus knew he needed the renewing breath of God in order to resurrect you and me. And so, in closing, this time of coronavirus is forcing us to learn new spiritual mathematics, a new calculation for soulful living, addition by subtraction, a subtraction of greed and profiteering for the addition of social justice, a subtraction of distraction and overworking for the addition of healthier love and deeper faith, and a subtraction of public affirmation for the addition of greater self-knowing. This new spiritual math is far more art than science. And so I feel that I have license to close with a poem that I wrote. There's a math that hopes to train the calculating human brain. Science, engineering aims depend on arithmetic games. But there's a math that isn't new, that molds our moral attitude. Arithmetic so tried and true, as ancient as religion's view. A formula of heart and soul for how to live in love its goal. To see the pluses for the whole if we subtract and pay our toll. This sacred math did Jesus teach. Lose yourself, he did beseech. Subtract your greed and ego reach. Then the world shall profit, all and each. If we just learn to sacrifice and take enough that will suffice, and gladly pay the needy price, we'll help restore God's paradise. Amen. And shall we close our worship this morning by sharing the words of the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.